Hi, I'm Arushi Pitsre from ChooseLevers.com, and I'm going to talk to you today about the six buttons that I think you really need to understand on your Instant Pot. Of course, there are a lot more buttons. We've all seen the control panel that looks like a rocket ship is about to take off. And it's very intimidating sometimes, you know, especially if it's your first time. So I'm going to try to break it down for you on the buttons that you really need to understand. So I'm going to talk about the six buttons that I think do fundamentally different things. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about how those buttons differ. And if you think six is still too many and it's confusing, I'm going to break it down to just two buttons that you actually need. So if you're a newbie, you might actually appreciate that. Six basic buttons. So in my mind, here are the buttons that do something that is quite different, each button from the other. So for example, the saute button, what the saute button does is very, very different from what the pressure cook or the manual select button does, very different from how the steam button operates, what the soup, yogurt, and slow cook do, okay? So if you were to think about what do I really need if I were to, you know, sort of exploit its full potential, I would say this would be a really good starting point for you. Okay, so let's just talk about kind of how the buttons differ. So it's a common misperception that the buttons are only different in terms of timing, that, you know, the meat button versus the rice button, they only differ in terms of timing. And actually that's not the case. So I don't have any information from Instant Pot, you know, on the inside down low. All I know is what I read, and I read manuals. I'm also not an engineer, I'm a data scientist. And so what I'm really good at is interpreting graphs. And I, you know, I'm a nerd, so I read like a maniac. So I learned things from that, and this is kind of what I'm sharing with you. So what I have learned from looking at the charts is that the buttons seem to differ in three fundamental ways. One is the time. So how long something is time for the meat and chili button versus the poultry button, different settings on that. But then the other thing is whether or not things are coming up to pressure. That's a difference. And then the other thing I see is that there's a difference in temperature ranges. So I'll talk a little bit about that as we go through. Okay, so time, temperature, and pressure all seem to make a difference. So the saute button is the easiest one. So now let me just caveat this. Every one of these buttons has a high, medium, low setting. Some have a high, low, some have a whatever. We're not gonna worry about it, okay? And you don't need to worry about it. Just start with the default settings and then things will become clear over time. The saute button, think of it exactly like you would your stovetop. When you want to brown something, the saute button is the one to use. If you turn it on, by default, it's gonna come on to high. Just leave it that way and you're all set. You can brown things, you can do things. If in doubt, and you're not quite sure how to set the pressure, or how, you know, are you supposed to run on poultry or meat or whatever, just use the high pressure button, okay? Just use the manual or pressure cook button, and that should work just fine. That is the default. It's going to default to high pressure, and you can just run the recipe the way it's written for 5 minutes or whatever. Okay, the soup button. I'm going to talk about the soup button a little bit because in my mind it does something quite fundamentally different. So what I did was I looked at the charts on the manual. And if you look at the charts on the manual, what it's showing you is that it comes up to temperature really, really slowly. And then towards the end of the cook cycle, it comes up higher. And what the manual tells us is it prevents things from coming to a rolling boil. Okay, as a cook, why would you need this? I can think of at least two circumstances in my work where I need this. And one of them is, you know, when you're trying to make bone broth and you don't want the broth to get cloudy. You don't want the meat and the marrow and everything to just kind of boil and just get to leaching into the broth, if you will. That's a terrible term for food, but you understand what I'm saying. So if you're trying to make a really, really clear broth, soup is a good setting. The other times I use it is when I don't want dairy products to curdle. So if I'm using something like I'm making on my ChooseLevers.com blog, and by the way, in my cookbook, which you see over here. Let me just digress for a minute. I have an Indian Instant Pot cookbook. It's available on Amazon. It shows you how to make 56 different recipes. Most of them are dead simple. They don't require exotic ingredients. So I hope you'll check the book out. But in that book is a yogurt and spinach sort of a sauce to make a chicken curry with. And when you use the soup button, what happens is the temperature comes up so slowly that the mixture gets fairly well cooked and homogenized before it comes up to really high pressure. So otherwise what might happen if you look at some of my other videos where I've talked about how food cooks in the pressure cooker, dairy might separate. So there's a series of videos on adapting for the pressure cooker. And if you look on that, you'll see dairy can sometimes separate. The soup button keeps it from separating, okay? Steam. The way the steam button appears to work is that temperature in the pot comes up fast. It comes up fast and it stays up the whole time during the cook cycle. So if you think about it as a cook, why might you use this? When you turn the Instant Pot on, the time that it takes to come up to pressure, there's heat generated and the food starts to pre-cook, right? It's not like the food says, I'm just gonna hang out here until pressure is achieved and then I'll cook. It cooks the whole time. What happens with steam is because it brings it up to pressure fast, something like a delicate vegetable or a fish doesn't get overcooked because temperature comes up fast. When temperature comes up fast, pressure comes up alongside that. And so the food comes to pressure really quick and it cooks really quick. And especially if you do QR, like a quick release afterwards, it keeps delicate vegetables and fish and seafood from getting overcooked. So that's an instance where you might use steam. One caveat, the temperature comes up so fast that you really don't want to put the food on the liner itself flat. You really want it elevated with a steamer rack or a pot and pot or something else. Don't put your chicken or fish or whatever directly in the liner when you're using steam. You will likely get scorching with that one, so be careful. The yogurt, there's multiple settings on the yogurt. You can boil, pre-boil the milk, etc. I don't do any of that. If you look on the Two Sleevers blog, there's a very simple Vietnamese yogurt recipe you should check out, and then there's a Greek yogurt recipe. As long as you use ultra-pasteurized milk that has already had the protein denatured once, you actually don't need to reheat the milk and you can still get thick yogurt. So, yogurt setting, it's actually very simple. Start with the Vietnamese yogurt recipe. It's a no-brainer. You don't have to heat, don't have to strain, don't have to do anything. It's a little bit sweet. You can't do it all the time, but it's a good starter recipe. So the way I make yogurt is I don't heat up the milk. I let it come to room temperature, and then I whisk it in with the starter, and then I pour it into little jars, and I put the jars in. And then the pressure cooker, the Instant Pot, creates a temperature somewhere between, I want to say 85 and 110, and the yogurt incubates in it. The good news about this is not just yogurt, right? In that environment, you can sprout beans. So if you've soaked your beans overnight or they've plumped up with all the water, you can sprout beans, you can proof bread. If you're proofing bread, the one thing to remember is please do not use your regular Instant Pot lid. The bread comes up with such enthusiasm that sometimes it's blocked the lid and people have had trouble. So use a glass lid, use something else. It doesn't really matter. You're not creating pressure. You're just keeping it covered so things don't fall in and the temperature stays in. So the yogurt setting, don't be limited by just thinking it only makes yogurt. It makes other things. And then the slow cook. Okay, this is the most maligned function on the Instant Pot. Honestly, with good reason. The slow cooker works. Okay, it works. It does not work intuitively for all of us who've had years and years of cooking with the slow cooker. Here's where the difference is. This legend on the whatever side it is, I'm really spatially challenged, so it's either your left or your right. It's on that side, where it says low equal keep warm, medium equal low, high equal high. Let me explain that. If you turn your Instant Pot on to low and you put your food in thinking, oh, I'm gonna be at work, I'll come back home, there'll be lovely chicken in here. No, it'll be raw chicken in there because that low setting is like a keep warm setting on every other slow cooker that you and I have ever worked with. Okay, so just remember low equal keep warm. Low does not equal low cooking. If you wanted to cook on low, you actually have to put the Instant Pot on medium. I don't know why they did that, but that's how it is. Okay, so if you want to cook chicken on low, you're going to actually have to use the medium setting. And then if you want to cook something on high, you use the high setting. So the way to remember this is for cooking, the only two acceptable settings for the slow cooker are medium and high. That's all you need to know. Okay, so let me just recap really quick here what happens. Saute is good for using like a stovetop. Manual or pressure cook is your default. The recipe doesn't specify what button to use. Press manual, set your minutes, go. Soup is good if you're trying to not overboil something to keep a broth clear or to not have dairy separate. Steam is really good for delicate things like fish and vegetables that you want to come up to high pressure really quick. Do not put it on the liner, put it on a rack. Yogurt, if you've never made yogurt before, try it without the pre-boiling, see how you think, and then you can boil it the next time. There's an incubate setting. Remember, the incubate can be used for anything that thrives under a warm environment, such as proofing bread dough, making dosa batter if you're cooking Indian food, and then also, what was the third thing? Oh, yeah, sprouting beans, right? And then on the slow cook, you don't need the low setting. That's like keep warm unless you're making like a Rotel dip or, you have a party, you're trying to keep something warm. But really all you need is medium and high. Okay, I know there's some of you going, my head is spinning. There's still six buttons. Like I don't even know where to start. Actually, you don't need to know all the six buttons. The six buttons would make you a very sophisticated Instant Pot user. You need two buttons, maybe one. Okay, if there's only one button that I would suggest you learn is play around with the manual or the pressure cook button. That one, learn how it works, press everything around it, you know, just get familiar with that one. There are a ton of recipes on twoslievers.com. I think there are 56 recipes where you just pour everything, you press the pressure cooker button, you put in the minutes, you walk away. That's all you need to know. Okay, so don't be intimidated. It's not that complicated. There are 10 safety features that will keep you safe. Just go ahead and start with learning only the saute if you want to pre-brown something. Before you pre-brown, look at my video on the Maillard reaction and see why you may not even need to do that. And then just learn how to use your manual, adjust buttons up and down for time, and that's really all you need to know. So yes, you could look at all of the buttons, or you could say, look, I'm gonna get started, and here are the two buttons that I need to know. Okay, so that was my quick video on the six buttons that I think you need. I really appreciate your watching. I do want to plug the book one last time. The book is a great deal, y'all. It's not even the cost of one entree at an Indian restaurant. And people who've never had Indian food are loving the recipes in it. People who have had and cook Indian food are loving the recipes in it. And, you know, people who are extremely familiar with cooking it love the ease of it. So I do hope you'll check it out. Look for Indian Instant Pot on Amazon or look for my name, Urvashi. There's only one Urvashi Pitsner on Google, by the way, in case you wondered. So anyway, go ahead and check it out. And thank you very much for watching this video. I'm Urvashi Pitsner from twoslievers.com, and there's 100 million ways to follow me, including subscribing to this YouTube channel. So thank you very much.